There's no doubt that Isaac Newton was one of the greatest scientists that ever lived. He united our observational experience of gravity on Earth to the motion of the stars. He showed that gravity experienced by a falling apple can be described by exactly the same equation as the gravity experienced by Earth going around the Sun. Newton's equation was considered gospel for hundreds of years. It was noticed, however, that Newton's equation did not quite predict the observed motion of the planet Mercury, the planet closest to the Sun. Mercury has something called a precession. This means that its elliptical orbit around the Sun varies slightly every time it goes around the Sun, and this shift in orbit was much more severe than predicted by Newton's laws. No one could explain it. In 1859, French mathematician Urbain Le Verrier proposed that this odd motion of Mercury could be explained by a kind of dark matter. This dark matter he proposed was an unseen small planet called Vulcan that lay somewhere between Mercury's orbit and the Sun. Of course, no one could find such a planet, but scientists explained that this planet was obscured because the Sun was so bright that anything small in front or in back of it could not be seen. This theory held until the 1920s when Einstein's theory of general relativity more precisely described the laws of gravity, and it perfectly predicted the observed precession of Mercury due to the curvature of spacetime. So the dark matter called Vulcan turned out to really be due to an error in Newton's laws. By the same token, is it possible that what we have invented as dark matter to explain the motion of stars and galaxies and clusters is like Le Verrier's planet Vulcan, a figment of our imagination? Could it be that Einstein's general relativity has a flaw? This is a serious school of thought among some scientists that has surprising evidence to support it. The details are coming up right now. This video is about the true nature of reality, but if you're like me, once in a while you just want to escape reality and be immersed in total fantasy. If you're into that, then get ready to be hooked on Raid Shadow Legends, today's sponsor. Raid Shadow Legends is a turn-based roleplay game done right, and it's free. I don't play video games all that much, but this was so easy to play and get into that it pulled me right in. It's absolutely visually stunning. The graphics are rendered in incredible detail. It's like being the hero of a movie. It's a mobile experience game, but it's also available for PC, and it can be played cross-device. And what many players have been waiting for, Battle Pass Season 1 is live now. You can win awesome rewards, including free energy refills, gems, and new champions by fulfilling daily and weekly challenges. Guys, if you want to have some fun, then click on the description right now and get 200,000 silver and one free champion, Treefeller. That Treefeller. All that treasure and Treefeller is waiting right here, but only for the next 30 days. And did I tell you that it's free? Click on the link in the description to start having some fun. As I showed in a previous video, Vera Rubin in the 1970s verified that stars in the outer edges of galaxies are moving around the galactic center at about the same speed as those closer to the center. But according to the laws of gravity, they should be moving much slower because the effect of gravity goes down by the square of the distance. This can be seen in the motion of Earth and all the planets in our solar system. The planets further away from the Sun are moving much slower than the planets closer to the Sun. But for some reason, this inverse square law does not appear to work based on the mass of all the visible matter in galaxies. The motion of stars, for example, in the Milky Way galaxy is about 200 kilometers per second, regardless of its distance from the center. You can see how this occurs on this computer simulation. The left shows how the galaxy should behave based on all the visible matter. The galaxy simulation on the right is how the galaxy actually behaves. Note how the motion of stars on the outer edges are much faster than they should be. This faster than predicted motion, it was theorized, is due to the extra unseen matter, or dark matter, that surrounds all galaxies. And the amount of dark matter needed to make this galaxy behave the way that it does is about 6 times more than the observable matter. So this dark matter makes up about 85% of all matter, and 15% is the visible matter that we can see. But in decades of research, no one so far has detected a dark matter particle. Could it be, like the planet Vulcan, that it actually doesn't exist? And could this motion be equally explained by a modification of general relativity? General relativity has been shown to be highly accurate for massive objects that are very short distance apart, up to several light years. But when it comes to the galaxy, however, we're looking at radius of 50,000 light years and clusters that are millions of light years across. Is it possible that gravity behaves very differently at thousands of light years across than it does at, say, 1 light year across? Is there a better, more accurate theory than general relativity? In 1983, Israeli physicist Mordechai Milgram published a hypothesis showing that a modification of Newtonian mechanics could almost perfectly explain our observations. Milgram noticed that in the centers of galaxies, no dark matter needs to be invoked because there's enough ordinary matter to explain the motions of stars. Only in the outskirts is the motion so fast that we need to invoke dark matter to explain the data. What Milgram found was that if you calculate using just the laws of Isaac Newton, the acceleration due to gravity at the point where ordinary matter is no longer sufficient, where you need to invoke dark matter to explain the velocity of stars, this acceleration was the same for every galaxy. In other words, there was some critical value of acceleration such that if the acceleration was larger than that value, you didn't need dark matter. But when the acceleration was smaller, you did need dark matter. So what Milgram said is that maybe there isn't any dark matter. Maybe we just need to modify the theory of gravity such that if the acceleration is greater than a certain value, it's a 1 over the radius squared, as Newton's equations indicate. But at smaller accelerations, gravity has a force that is greater than that. Maybe it falls off at a 1 over the radius instead of radius squared. Now, it may have sounded crazy to make Newton's laws change this way. But the remarkable thing is that if you invoke Milgram's hypothesized modification of gravity, it fits the data like a glove, almost perfectly. It fits our observations of motions of stars, not just in our own galaxy, but dozens of other galaxies. The lines here are the predicted values, and the points with the error bars are the actual measured data points. So the idea that you don't need dark matter and that Newton's laws work just fine inside a certain radius, but a modification of Newton's laws works on the outside of this radius, seems to make it work quite well in galaxy after galaxy. Milgram's hypothesis is called modified Newtonian dynamics, or MOND. And as you can see from the data, it cannot be ignored. Both the idea of MOND and the theory of a dark matter halo surrounding galaxies seems to work equally well. But since we haven't detected dark matter in decades of looking for it, why don't we just adopt Milgram's hypothesis as a new scientific theory and get rid of the idea of dark matter as a particle altogether? Is there any problem with Milgram's theory? Well, it turns out there is. And as you know, there are very few things that work perfectly in science. The problem is that while Milgram's theory explains the motion of stars within galaxies exceptionally well, it does not explain the motion of clusters of galaxies. This means that the bullet cluster that I talked about in the previous video is not explained by Milgram's theory. In this cluster, the pink areas is where ordinary matter in the form of interstellar gas reacts with itself and can be seen as X-rays. But gravitational lensing indicates that the majority of the mass in this cluster is located in the blue areas, where less ordinary matter can be seen. So there must be unseen dark matter in these areas, as indicated by the gravitational lensing. This is very strong evidence for the idea of dark matter being a particle. This cannot be explained or predicted by Milgram's modifications of Newton's equations. And many scientists have tried very hard to make MOND work in these cases, but have been unsuccessful. So most proponents of MOND today believe that you cannot get rid of the idea of a dark matter particle altogether. So maybe both ideas are correct, and maybe we need both a modification of Newton's laws as well as dark matter particles to fully explain our observations of both the motions of stars within galaxies on scales of tens of thousands of light years and the motions of clusters of galaxies millions and billions of light years across. One benefit of adopting both ideas would be that it would allow the possibility that the dark matter you would need to explain the behavior of clusters of galaxies may be different. It may be ordinary matter rather than the popular candidates of dark matter, namely WIMPs and axions, which are theoretical and have actually never been detected. This dark matter could perhaps be ordinary matter, such as neutrinos. Now, as I said in my previous dark matter video, scientists don't think neutrinos can explain the motion of stars and galaxies because neutrinos are hot, meaning they move too fast to allow halo formations around galaxies. but they do move slowly enough that they could form halos around clusters of galaxies on the scales of millions of light years across, such as the Bullitt cluster. So proponents of MOND now believe that motions within galaxies can be explained by modifications of Newton's gravity, and the behavior of clusters of galaxies can be explained by some type of ordinary matter, such as neutrinos, or as yet unseen dark matter like WIMPs and axions. So while it was the dream of many physicists and MOND proponents to get rid of the idea of dark matter altogether, I think it's very difficult, if not impossible. The Bullitt cluster, for one, makes perfect sense if there is dark matter, but makes no sense if there's only ordinary matter. But another nagging reason is the microwave background radiation. This is the way the universe looked at about 380,000 years after the Big Bang, about 13.4 billion years ago. And its structure tells us a lot about the way ordinary matter came together to form protons and neutrons in a process called nucleosynthesis. And based on matching our observations with predictions made by known equations, we can estimate the amount of ordinary matter in the universe, and it's 5%. But the critical amount of matter needed to make a flat universe, that is, a universe that is not curved in four dimensions, like our observations indicate, is 30%. So this means 25% of this 30% cannot be ordinary matter. This number matches perfectly with our observations of galaxy rotations. So because our observations show that the maximum amount of normal protons and neutrons are not more than 5%, the remaining 25% has to be a different kind of particle and not an ordinary particle. And this fact is really important to understand if you want to buy into the MOND versus dark matter particle theories. There are many things that we don't know, as I said in a previous video. There are unknown unknowns, meaning things that we don't even know that we don't know. But dark matter is not one of them. Dark matter is a known unknown, meaning it is something that is known to exist, but we just haven't found it yet. But given the number of people working on it and the extraordinary efforts being made to find it, I feel that we're on the cusp of discovering it. And I'm glad that we live at a time in human history when we will make this kind of momentous discovery. If you haven't already, be sure to check out my previous video on what kind of particles dark matter could be, and let me know what you think about dark matter in the comments below. I'll see you in the next video, my friend. Arvinash here. If you like our videos, then consider subscribing and ring the bell so that you can be informed when we upload more fascinating videos. We'll see you in the next video.